All right, so thank you everyone for being here. So as I said, materials are online. You can download them to be able to follow along. So I would recommend you to do this. You don't have to. This tutorial is a bit of an exercise for me because basically, I thought that this is something that the Python community, the SciPy community needs, which is to like give a bit of big picture on how to do some statistics in Python. And so I forced myself to do it. So it's not only the first time I give it, but I've also been off on vacation for 3 weeks, coming back on Monday. So it's going to be an experience. An experiment, I should say. So I usually do predictive modeling, so scikit-learn type of things, but this is focused towards statistics and not predictive modeling, and I'll discuss this a bit. So I'm going to switch to the materials. Hopefully everybody have it. Elsewhere, the URL is over there, and if like people come in late, can you please like help them, being their neighbors, to get the URL? Okay, so here we go. So we're going to be using pandas and stat models mostly, and a bit seaborne. I'll mention this as we go. So hopefully you do have these dependencies installed. So first, what do I mean by statistics? Here, I mean mostly inferential statistics, which I find you don't hear enough about these days. And the idea being, if I have a claim about, I don't know, interaction between wages and race or gender, what are the chances that what I'm observing in my data that is supporting this claim is purely random, okay? So basically, can I give a confidence interval on my claim? Can I back my claim? And that is inferential statistics. And examples are you're a judge. You're going to make a ruling about, say, the fact that some factory has an impact on some form of cancer, and you're basing your ruling on data. Given that there are many factories in many cancers, is this data supporting your hypothesis that a specific factory is implying a specific cancer, okay? So that's the kind of questions that we're going to be interested in here. And that is different from predictive modeling. I'm not saying it's completely unrelated, but it's a different goal, right? Okay?
So can I just ask, is there a notebook right like this, or is this a...
This is not a notebook. I think I will not be using the notebook during the tutorial. Mostly because I want to be able to show both the material and the prompt. So no, there's no notebook available. Everything, all the material is available, but that's all there is. There isn't more. So in terms of tools for statistics, for typically these statistical questions, so inferential statistics. The king of the hill is the R language. It's been used over the years in things like biostatistics, in econometrics. So basically, it allows you to ask all these questions really, really well. So I guess I'm preaching to the choir, but why would we want to use Python? And I think the important point is one tool to do many, many different problems. And I suspect that, out of curiosity, how many people here use sometimes inferential statistics, p-values, tests, things like this, show of hands. Wow, that's a lot. I was expecting much less. Well, all you guys may know more than I do. Maybe. Right, so the point is, it's really useful to be able to combine many, many things. And Python is really good at this. So in terms of, can I decrease the font size? Let me try. I'll decrease the font size once. How's that in the back? Good? Okay. Can I try once more? That's probably, is it still good? Okay. So I'll start a bit with the kind of data representations that we have. So my goal here is to talk to people who do not do data analysis or statistical analysis, because I find there is somewhat of a gap between people who are very familiar with those concepts and who explains those they explain those concepts with terminology and prerequisites that basically assume that you know this field. And so I'd like to bridge this gap. And so I'll assume that people don't have to be familiar with data analysis. So I'll first discuss a bit the data representation and introduce basically the pandas world very quickly. Then I'll talk a bit about hypothesis testing and say comparing two groups with a few tests. Then I'll go into linear models, and that's, I think, maybe the strongest contribution of this tutorial, and try to dissect a bit how to use a formulas framework to ask a bunch of different questions. I'll cover a bit visualization with Seaborn, then I'll mention a bit interactions. That's the goal. I don't know how long things will take, so if we finish early, we'll just go on. So first, data representation. So I don't come, as you might have guessed, I don't come from a background in statistics, but I do believe I come from a background in data analysis. So when I hear people that do statistics that talk about data analysis, I have the feeling that we're talking about different worlds. For them, everything is a data frame. For me, I do image analysis. I do signal processing. And these are not data frames. So it took me a really long time to realize why there were value in a data frame. So basically, the typical problem set we have is we have a set of different observations that we may call observations or samples or individuals, subjects. And they're described with a set of different features. That is fairly universal. Even if I have images, I can pitch it this way. And in many situations, those individuals are described by features of very different natures. So here we have a data set of brain size and IQ. And so it comes as a CSV file. And we can see that we think we have information like different measures of IQ. So FSIQ, VIQ, PIQ are different measures of IQ. The weight and height of the person, but also his or her gender. So that's typically the kind of data that we might have, and we can see that it's very inhomogeneous. So think of it as a table in a spreadsheet. And basically, any data, you can somewhat force it to be that way, almost. But that's the kind of data that we're going to be working with. And so we're going to be manipulating panda data frames for this. So using the pandas module. And the first thing we can do is load this data. So now I'm going to switch into like interactive mode. So I'm going to type this along. And you can, if you have the material, you can copy paste if you want. You can remove the output by clicking the little arrow to copy paste. So I think I'll be typing along to force myself to slow down. So I'm going to start at Python. You're welcome to do this in the notebook, by the way. I'm going to import pandas. And I'm going to read my data. Because it comes as a CSV file, I'm going to read it using read CSV, okay? So if at some point I type too fast, do remember that everything I type is in the online material. Okay, so I'm going to read this, and although this is called a CSV file, if you scroll up here, you can see that it's separated by semicolons, right? So technically it's not a CSV file. It's a semicolon separated file. So I'm going to have to tell pandas that the separator is a semicolon. And so I'm going to do this. Where am I? Not at all in the right place. All right, so I'm going to start again. Okay, so if we do this, I'm going to use head to just plot the first few lines. So if we do this, what can we see? This thing here, a dot, right? So some data, depending on the field you're in, has missing value. This person's weight was not measured or lost. So here we are going to have to tell pandas that the dot here is a missing value. And in the statistic world, this is known as not available, NA. So once again, if you come from statistics, this is obvious that NA means a non-available. If you come from something else, you have no clue what NA means. All right, and so now I'm going to look at my data frame. And now the not available data is represented as an N, okay? It's going to be useful for later. All right, so that's my data set. Now, my data may not come in a CSV file, right? So if I have, say, NumPy arrays that describe my data that were loaded or created in other ways, I can create a panda data frames out of them. I don't have to like store them as a CSV file and reload it. So I'm going to create a few NumPy arrays. Oops. Just like do time that varies from -6 to 6 with 20 data points. And I'm going to, you know, create sine t, which is going to be the sine of this guy, and cosine t, which is the cosine of this guy. Okay, so then I may want to create a data frame that has these three values. And the way I can do it is you can think of data frames as dictionaries of 1D arrays. That's a good way of thinking of them. So I can create the corresponding data frame using the direct constructor, panda data frame. And then I'm going to give it the dictionary that gives names and the corresponding variables. Okay? Right, so if I do this, then I have a data frame with the names I've given, so t, sine, cosine, and the values, right? So that's our typical object. And there are many other ways of reading it. So you can do things like load it from Excel files, although that might be a bit tedious because Excel files do not enforce a specific structure. You can load it from a SQL database. So panda data frames have different methods than NumPy arrays. In a way, they're a bit similar to a 2D NumPy array. For instance, you can look at their shape. So that's the data I've loaded from the brain size. And it's got 40 rows and 8 columns. So it's basically 40 individuals that are described by 8 attributes. All right? So we can look at the names of the columns. And we have an unnamed column, and then gender, different versions of IQ, weight, height, and MRI count. Okay? And then we can look at the gender. So we can address the columns as in a dictionary by using square brackets and giving the name. You can also use a shorthand like this, which allows tab completion. This might not always work because the name of your column might have, say, a space. So in general, I would at least like push you not to write scripts using this kind of things. For interactive work, maybe. All right, and then this data can be selected a bit in the same way that a numpy array might be selected. So for instance, if I want to take the mean VIQ of all the females, I'm going to take the data, and then I'm going to select it. So write a selector where I select the gender female, all right? So if I do this, I'm going to have my data frame that's only for females. And then I can grab out of this the VIQ column, okay? So notice that you're sometimes selecting, in, when you're selecting in the row direction. But when you're asking for a name, you're asking in the column direction. So it's powerful, but maybe ambiguous. And then I can ask the mean of this guy. All right? So that is the mean of the VIQ column for data for which gender is female, okay? So in a sense, that's not terribly different from a numpy array. So it may be useful to call the describe method to get a quick summary of the different columns. So for each column, for each numerical column, it's going to give us a summary, like how many entries are there, what's the mean, what's the standard deviation. These are percentiles, so the 25th percentile, the median. Okay? That's a way of getting a quick glance at your data. So another useful feature of data frames are the group by. So what we've just done above, we've just selected for females and then computed the mean of the VIQ. We might want to do this for males also. So we might you know, do a for loop and say, look at what are the different unique values of data gender, and then select. So the group by method is meant for this. So group by, you will give it one or several columns that you want to select upon. And it's going to give you an object that is basically, it's multiple views on your data frames for the different values of gender. So the first thing is it's iterable. So I'm gonna call, sorry. I'm going to call this object group by gender, and I'll use it late as we go. All right? So I can iter on it, and if I iter on it, it's going to return successively the value of so the selector it used, so the value, so the gender, and then a sub data frame that corresponds to this. Okay. So if I do this, I'm going to get successively females and males, or vice versa. And as I'm computing the mean, it's computing the mean of every single column, what I've just typed above. So I'm getting, for female, I'm getting the mean of all the different values. And for male, the same thing. OK? So then I can say, OK, I just want to have the VIQ. So notice how I'm selecting VIQ and group by gender. So group by gender is somewhat of a complex object that knows how to select columns before the iteration. And then I'm just getting the mean VIQ for male and female, OK? So that can be useful to quickly have a look at your data set. And then group by object is even more powerful. And you can just directly compute the mean, in which case it's going to compute the mean for each column for females and males, OK? So one thing that we don't have to worry about here, because it's a very small data set, is that these things are implemented in a very clever way to minimize memory consumption and also to be extremely fast. So if you have data that barely fits into memory, I suspect that what I've just wrote will work. Which, if you were to do this, I mean, it's feasible to do this. You can write code with NumPy that will work as well, but it's going to require knowing what to do. All right? So let's do a small exercise, really just getting familiar with this. So can you compute the mean value for the VIQ for the full population? Can you tell me how many males and females were included in the study? And just use tab completion to find what's useful on a panda data frame to do this. And can you compute the average MR count in log units, both for males and females? Just getting used to the data structure. right? So the first one is fairly simple. Just take the column VIQ of data and compute the mean on it. So it's 112. So how many males and females were included in the study? Well, I can use the group by gender and call the count method on it. And what you find is interestingly, it tells us that we have missing data for weight and height, okay? Because the count for weight and height is not the same as the count for the others. So we had 20 males and 20 females, but we have missing data for weight and height. So what's the average value of MR counts expressed in log units for males and females? So that's typically, I believe, the kind of situations where you need to move away a bit from pandas, because I'm asking a log. So I'm going to have to use NumPy. So what I've done here, I don't know if there's a more elegant solution, but what I've done here is simply iterate. And then the value is just a one-dimensional a data structure. So I can just take the log of it and compute the mean, OK? Worse for you?
Just then take out the MRI counts.
Oh, the MRI counts. Oh, good idea, yeah. Typos?
Without S. And then I did dot mean on this.
Ah! But what you're doing is not the same thing. The mean of the log is not the log of the mean. Yeah, that would work, but it's not the same thing. Well, when you compute dot mean, you're going to get, so basically many panda data frames and panda series can often be casted to NumPy arrays. They implement the __ array or the array interface. So that's why it worked. Oh, but that's the subclassing. That's the subclassing mechanism. Yeah. It's an array subclass.
Okay, so one shouldn't rely on it.
I'm very surprised it gives the same result. That should be a time. That should be a series.
Is it?
Yeah, it's a series. So the nonlinearity of the log is not expressed. Okay. Good catch. As a general rule, we in the lab have found that it's very easy to shoot yourself in the foot with pandas, like terribly easy, because it's extremely expressive. So it's really easy to do things that you think you know what it's doing, but it's actually doing something different. So like general rule, check what you're doing when you're using pandas.
You could create a new column out of the log of MRI.
Yeah, that's another way of doing it. Let's do it this way. So data, I'm going to create a new column, log MRI. And yeah, that's a great way of doing it. And I'm going to call np log of data MRI. Well, I can use tab completion here. It's going to make my life easier. And then I can recompute my group by gender and group by gender of MRI count dot mean. Log MRI. Yeah, so yeah, that's a beautiful way of doing it. So typically we do these things. We add columns. Just like people who are really fluent with Excel, they're going to add a column to sort.
I just want to say another way to do it is to give a lambda function to.
Yeah, I hate this. I find it's completely unreadable and super easy to shoot yourself in the foot. Yeah, that's really something I would avoid. Personal preference. Okay, just minor thing. This a box plot. You can click on it if you want to see the code that generates it, but it's actually just a group by gender dot box plot. So for certain common use cases, you can do things in like a one liner. All right. I'm doing okay on time. So some simple plotting. Panda does come with simple plotting that are really useful. And so typically, you can look at a scatter matrix. Actually, I need to remove my column now. Well, no, I don't need to remove my column. So I'm going to import plotting from pandas. So it's in pandas.tools. And then I'm going to plot what's known as a scatter matrix. And I'm going to plot it only on the, I'm going to select, oh, something very nasty here. Notice the two square brackets? You need those two square brackets, right? If you don't put those two square brackets, you're going to get a meaningless error message. And there's a reason behind this, okay? So when you want to index a list of columns, you need to give it a list, okay? You can't just put commas. And if you're interested in the details, I believe that it's because you can have tuples as indexes. And so if you're not putting the square bracket, it creates a tuple. So that's something really important to keep in mind. In pandas, tuples and lists are not equivalent. Okay? So if you're writing algorithmic code that's passing in things to index, tuples and lists are not equivalent. All right. So that's our scatter matrix. So if you have, if you're looking at a small number of variables, scatter matrices are extremely useful things. What they show you is basically a histogram on the diagonal. So you've got a histogram of the weight, of the height, and of the MR count. Those units must be pounds, imperial. And then you've got scatter plots of, say, height as a function of weight. All right? So height as a function of weight. Well, you can see some form of a linear trend, right, going up. So it makes sense. And then MR counts. So MR counts is basically like the size of the brain measured by an MR scanner as a function of weight and of height. So it also goes up. So it's somewhat meaningful. Okay? So this is a really useful tool to look at multivariate data. So multivariate is the word in statistics for multidimensional. So it's really useful to look at a multivariate data with a small number of columns, okay? And I strongly suggest that you use it because you're going to see all kind of errors you made in putting the data or dependencies that you did not expect. So I strongly, and it's, you also can do sanity checking. So once again, the fact that, when weight increases, height increases, or vice versa, when height increases here, weight increases, that is telling us that it's things are somewhat meaningful. Okay? So we can look at dependencies between IQs. So same kind of ID, except that this time I'm going to use the different IQs. So what do we have? We have VIQ. Let me just check what we have. We have PIQ. So there are different measures of IQ. There's different ways of defining how to measure IQ. PIQ and FSIQ. FSIQ. All right, so if we do this, we'll get this, and typically it's kind of interesting because we see two clusters here, okay? So that's the kind of feature of your data that you will probably not see just by staring at the numerical values, all right? And so immediately we start thinking, what are those features? What are those clusters? Right? So any hypothesis? So here's an exercise. Can you? Yeah, I don't think so. No. So the way I do it is I simply do a selector. So data gender equals female versus male. Maybe there's a more crazy, clever way of doing it with group by, but I don't know. So when we look at this, what can we say? We can say that those two clusters are certainly not males and females, right? So that's typically playing between data visualization and hypothesis testing, even though we haven't like formally done a hypothesis testing. But in my opinion, it's extremely important to look at the data. It's important for me to do the two things: to look at the data and check whether figures whether hypotheses seem to be right or wrong, and also to formally do hypothesis testing. Both of them. I see too often one or the other. Maybe a lot of computer scientists or statisticians never look at the data and only run formulas. And inversely, a lot of people who don't have training in statistics never do actual testing. All right. Hypothesis testing. There we go. Any questions? Am I going too fast, too slow?
Show the selector.
Show the selector. Does that make sense? No, doesn't make sense. It does make sense. This is not too far from something you'd do in NumPy, right? Okay, hypothesis testing. So I guess the burning question is, and of course I've been tiptoeing around it since the beginning, can we compare the IQ of males and females, and are there significantly different, yes or no, based on this data set? So that's typically the kind of question, the statistical question. So we can compare the mean of one, the mean of the other, and claim, hey, I found a difference. Is this going to be meaningful in any way? That's what a hypothesis testing is for. And when we're comparing two groups, that's what we're doing. So we're going to start by doing this with SciPy. So we're going to import the stats module from SciPy. And the stat modules is nice because it comes with a large number of tests. In statistics, this is called a test. So it comes with a large number of tests. And the most common one, the simplest one, is what's known as the student's t-test. Okay? And so there is the one sample t-test, which you can use to test whether, so it's t-test one sample, and you can use to test whether observations drawn from a Gaussian distribution, that's the underlying assumption of the test, have a mean that is significantly different from zero, significantly different from a given value. So for instance, we can test whether in our data, the IQ is significantly different from zero. I was hoping to get a laugh here. No? Okay, it's getting late. So what does this return? So as usual, we can look at the doc string. So t-test one sample. And it says it returns two things, a t-statistic and a two-tailed p-value. What does this mean? The t-statistic is a number that is specific to the t-test, and basically the bigger it is, the more significant the difference is. And it's weakly related to, say, take the effect and divide it by the standard deviation. Okay? So if you have this in mind, if my standard deviation is much bigger than my effect, then it's not significant. If it's much smaller, then it's significant. It's not this, but it's weakly related to this. And the other thing is a p-value. So the p-value in statistics is the probability that the contrary of what you're testing, which we call the null hypothesis, is true. Okay? So, if you think about this, if I have a p-value of 1, is my hypothesis true or not? What's the definition? It's the probability that my null hypothesis is true. So if it's 1, it means that my null hypothesis is always true. Therefore, the hypothesis that I'm testing is always false, okay? So here I'm testing whether the VIQ is equal to 0. And I get a p-value of e to the minus 28. Is the VIQ, can I claim that the VIQ is different than 0? Right. I have 1 to the power minus 28 chances that under my null hypothesis, by chance, I find this distribution. Okay? So importantly, in statistics, it's always based on a set of assumptions, which is basically the distribution of your errors. Basically, what's the noise generating process? All right? I'm going to skip this exercise, but basically, we can think of it this way. I have errors that are distributed in a certain way. Under the null hypothesis, they're centered in zero. I'm observing things that are around here, okay? I can test a two-sided test, which is basically my null hypothesis is that thing that the IQ is zero, or a one-sided test, which is my null hypothesis is that the IQ is zero or below, okay? Am I looking at the tails of the null distribution on both sides or only one side? All right? So typically, that's going to give you a factor of 2 in where you set your threshold in determining that something is significant or not. So conventionally, often in the statistics literature, you say that something is significant if it has chances occurring under chance, under the null distribution, that are below 5%, okay? So a p-value that is below 0.05. Now, if you're a physicist and you run Large Hadron Collider, the LHC, then you're going to want like 5 sigmas, which correspond to p-values of, I don't know, 10 to the minus 6 or something like this. So biologists and physicists have different standards, but they work with different problems. All right? So, two sample t-test. We have now two different populations, and we want to test whether their mean is equal or not. So we can take the VIQ for females and males and test the difference. So if those two values are different, we're going to be using t-test independent. So I'm going to select a female VIQ. So I'm going to do my selector. I'm going to select the VIQ.
Would it be possible to use the group by to do that?
There are tests implemented in pandas. But anyhow, I less and less use these tests manually. And I'll show you after what I use. I don't do this much anymore, and I'll explain why. So I'm basically just walking you through the principles, but then I won't use them. But yeah, there's testing in pandas. Okay, so then we have male VIQ and female VIQ, so we can just check that we've done things that look right. Okay, and then we can use stats.t-test independent, and we're going to compare males and females. All right? So is the difference significant? Can we claim something based on this data set? How do I know this? I look at the p-value. So the p-value is here, and it's 0.44 something. So it basically is telling me that under the null distribution, I've got 0.4 chances of observing this. So it's like strongly non-significant. We're not finding a difference here. All right? Now let us look at maybe a more interesting question, which is I have different ways of measuring IQ, okay? I have PIQ, VIQ, FSIQ. Are they giving the same answer or not? So I can do a test on this. So I can compare FSIQ and PIQ. All right. So what we're seeing here is that if I compare FSIQ and PIQ using an independent t-test, I'm not really seeing a significant difference, right? Does this allow me to claim that they're the same? No, why? The fact that I've not been able to detect the difference doesn't mean that there is one, that there is not one. I mean, it just means it's confounded by noise. I just cannot claim from a logical standpoint that there's no difference. So what's like the main source of variability between IQ? It's the subject, right? IQ varies across subject. So now I'm trying to compare FSIQ and PIQ across many different subjects, but they're going to vary hugely across each subject. So I can do what's called paired statistics, which is to say these two columns are really measuring the same thing across different subjects. So what really matters is the systematic difference, okay? Because we're looking at the same subjects. So this is known as paired statistics, and I can do this using t-tests related. And so I can compare these two. All right. And now, I can't claim that there are difference based on the standard threshold of 5%, right? But we're much closer. So what this is telling me is the way I ask the question, of course, will guide the kind of answer I'm getting, right? If I ask a silly question, I'll get no answer. If I ask a more relevant question, I have more chances to get an answer. And remember, I have only 40 measurements. So if I had 200 measurements, chances are the difference would be significant. Okay? More statistical power. This is absolutely equivalent to doing a one sample t-test on the difference, by the way. All right, so if I do FSIQ minus PIQ, so I need to tell it I want to compare it to zero, I get the same answer, okay? And really the way you can think of it is that those IQ values are varying across subject. What really matters is the difference between the two IQ values in a given subject, okay? And I can plot here, I've plotted the box plots of VIQ and FSIQ, and the error bars are huge, but they're really given by the fact that I've got different subjects, so basically jitters. Now if I plot the box plot of the difference, the error bar is much smaller, of course, because this difference is paired by subject. That's the notion of paired statistics, or also known as repeated measures, okay? And finally, you can vary the kind of tests that you're using, and the t-test assumes Gaussian errors, which if you don't have a lot of data is a valid assumption. It's like the simplest assumption you can do in statistics, so you should be using it if you don't have enough data to support a more complex assumption. Another very useful test is the Wilcoxon sign rank test, which is basically it makes less assumption on the data, which means it needs more data to work well, but it's basically looking at how many times you've got a crossover between, so how many times basically you invert VIQ and PIQ. So that's why it's called the rank test, and it's paired here. It's a paired rank test. So basically, I've got those two values, and it's looking basically at how many times VIQ is greater than PIQ, okay? You can see here that it's giving less statistical power. So it's giving a smaller, a bigger p-value, so a smaller significance on the same data because it needs more data to work well, because it makes less assumptions, okay? And if you're doing non-paired statistics, it's the Mann-Whitney-U test, right? So there's a bit of a zoo of tests, and you have to be a statistician to really understand them. But the t-test, the Wilcoxon, and the Mann-Whitney are maybe the most useful. Let's do the first part of the exercise, right? Testing the difference between weights between male and female. That should be easy. So which t-test will I use? What's that? No, okay, so what do you mean by difference? No.
The one that asks us to do population independent?
Yeah, independent population. I can't do paired statistics because I have no matching between males and females. I mean, I could look, say, across married couples if there's a systematic difference, but I need a matching, okay? So I'm gonna use the independent one, and I'm going to use the data, and I'm gonna select on gender equals female, and I'm gonna be looking at the weight, and data gender, so I need to get my, get it right in terms of, yeah, that looks right. And data square bracket data the gender equals male, there's no capital here, male, and I'm gonna look at the weight here also. All right, that got it wrong. Probably got the wrong values. Data the gender dot unique capitals. Was that? And then the thing is just gonna blow. Yeah. So what can I do? Yeah, they're missing data. The missing data are implemented in pandas using NANs. NANs are horrible things that blow up numerics. So I can do this. I can actually create a weight no NANs. And then I'm gonna call the drop NA. So drop non-available on this. Actually, this is not going to work. I need to create the data. No NANs, because then I'm going to have to select this guy. Drop NA. All right? And then let me just look at the shape of this guy compared to the shape of the data. Yeah, I dropped two guys. Dropped two persons for which there was no weights available. And we saw earlier this was the case. So. Yeah, that's absolutely correct. So if I wanted to do this well, I should just select gender and weight, drop NA on this guy, and use this. Absolutely correct. And then I can try this again. Or I could call drop NA after the selector also. Ooh, and I need to be careful because I need to be indexing on the same thing. All right. So, is there a difference? Yeah. Can you tell me who's heavier? I can know this from the sign of the t-statistic, which I told you was related to the mean divided by the standard deviation, okay? So it's negative, so it's females minus males negative. So who's heavier? Males. Does it make sense? I think so. Okie dokie. Right. So this is a bit tedious. It's fairly easy to get it wrong. It's very useful though, because if you're coding your own logic, you will probably want to call things this way, with writing the tests yourself, writing the selectors yourself. But what I'm going to show you next is a very powerful way of doing all these things and much more, which is related to things that are known in statistics as formulas, okay? And we're going to be able to redo all this and much more in a much more powerful way. All right, let's start with something that seems weakly related, which is linear regression. So what's the linear regression? I'm observing two things, say age as a function of weight, and I'm trying to link the two, and I'm going to use, say here, a linear model, which is basically that y is given by x time an unknown coefficient plus an intercept, which is the way in statistics we call the offset here, and some noise. And so this is a model that we're going to try to fit, and then maybe we can test things like, is the intercept non-zero, is the coefficient non-zero, okay? So we're going to do this by using what's known as an ordinary least square. So it's basically a least square regression. It assumes that errors are Gaussian. Stat models can do other kind of regressions. And we're going to test that coefficient is non-zero. So first, we're going to simulate data according to the model. So I'm going to create x that goes, that's linspace going from minus 5 to 5 with 20 data. I'm going to seed my random number generator because I want things to be reproducible. And I'm going to create normally distributed noise. So I'm creating noise that is exactly distributed accordingly to my model. So I'm going to say, basically, what I'm implementing here is the exact model. I'm going to say it's minus 5, y is minus 5, plus 3 times x, plus 4 times, and then I'm sampling normally distributed noise. Okay. Right. And then I'm going to create a data frame with this guy. Okay, just check that it looks okay, it looks okay. Right. And then the magic. I'm going to import, I'm going to use stat models. Stat models is basically the powerful package in Python to do statistical testing. And I'm going to use the formula API, which is extremely powerful. So from stat models, dot formula dot API, I'm going to import the OLS, the ordinary least square fit. And then I'm going to specify a model. And the way I specify this model is I'm saying that y is equal to x because by default it adds an intercept. So I can add the intercept this way if I want to be explicit. Okay, y is equal to x. And then what do y and x mean? They take their meaning in the panda data frame. So it's a bit related to things we've seen in Bokeh, for instance. So the panda data frame is the context for this formula. So I'm going to give it the panda data frame, and then I'm going to fit it, OK? So I'm specifying the relationship that I'm expecting in my data. Basically, y is related to x, and the coefficient is implicit. And the intercept is implicit, but I can write it here, the data in which I evaluate it and I fit it, okay? And then what I can do is I can inspect what this guy has learned. I call model.summary on it, right? And it gives me a summary of what it has learned. So it may be a bit tedious to learn, to read, because it's using statistics jargon, but it's also very useful to debug a bit what has happened. So you probably don't understand everything in there, so it's telling you that the dependent variable was y, that it's using an ordinary least square, so method is least square, it's giving you a lot of things. How many observations there were? 120, no, 20, right, makes sense. Okay? And what's most interesting here, this will display better on your screen because I had to blow up the font. What's interesting here is, yeah, I can't, if I decrease this, people at the back won't see. So it's giving me a table that that gives me, for the intercept and the coefficient of x, that gives me the coefficient, the standard error, okay? So coefficient that it has estimated, minus 5.5. Do you remember what would we expect here? Remember how we generated the data? We would expect minus 5, that's correct. So the standard error. Then it's giving me the related t statistic. So it's minus 5. And it's giving me the corresponding p-value. So it's like very small. I can't see it because the t statistic is large in absolute value. Therefore, the p-value is small. And it's giving me the confidence interval. Basically, my coefficient can lie anywhere under the null model between minus 7.7 and minus 3.3. Okay? And it's doing this for the intercept and the coefficient of x. Okay? Which, if we look at how we defined our model, how we generated our data, intercept, we're expecting minus 5, and coefficient of x, we're expecting 3. So the good news is we're pretty close. We're even in the confidence interval, which makes sense, OK? So that's really powerful. You, like in a few lines, you get a lot of information on the statistics under the null hypothesis.
Question.
Sure. That's a very good question. This does assume that there's no noise in X, and maybe hopefully we'll have time to come back to this. I should speed up, but yeah, that's a very good question. There are other statistical models that assume like, but they're uncommon. Right. I should speed up. So let me show you a few things. Let me give you, so model has been fitted. So we can try to retrieve the parameters, and we can tap complete. And I think it's in params, models.params is a panda series that gives us the coefficients of the models, so minus 5 and so. So basically, we can inspect models to find all these things. They're all in models, unsurprisingly. All right, oops. So that's all good, but that was a simple linear regression. We want to do things like two-group comparisons. So for this, we can use categorical variables. So if we go back to the data on brain size, and we need to reload this, I'm going to start copy-pasting in the interest of time. All right, so we have our data, and now we can So data to gender is not a number, it's not an N. It's what we call the categorical variable, okay? Males and females. So we can write an ordinary least square model that uses the categorical variable. So we're going to use the OLS. We're going to give it a formula, and we're going to say, I want to know whether VIQ is related to gender, and I'm going to add an intercept. And I'm going to express this in the data context, and I'm going to fit it. And then I'm going to look at the summary once again. And so let me look at it here. And what we're seeing is that we're seeing an intercept. So it's like the mean across the population of the IQ. And it's basically 110. And then so that's the coefficient. Then there's the offset, basically the effect of male on the intercept. So it's 5. We have the standard errors, and we have the t-value. So across the population, chances are the intercept is non-zero. But the t-value related to gender is extremely small. Okay, so it's not significant. Okay, and then you have a bunch of other tests.
So what does that mean?
The intercept is... It means that according to this model and our data, that's really important. According to this model and our data, the mean VIQ is around 110, and it's significantly non-zero. And the difference between males and females in VIQ is not significant. Therefore, you should not report it. You should not say the difference between males and females IQ is around 6, but it's not significant. That's bullshit, period. The reason I chose this male and female is that it's something that we might debate, say, after having drunk too much. And so it's important, I mean, what kind of bullshit you might read in the news on data. It's where statistical testing is important, because it tells you that I may see this, but it doesn't mean anything, all right? So importantly, stat models was clever enough to detect that gender was a categorical variable. But if I had coded gender as zeros and one, it would think that it's a numerical variable. So then I need to force it using this syntax, categorical gender, okay? So we can redo the test between FSIQ and PIQ, all right? Now we have a slight difficulty. Let's look at our data. Just look at the head. So we have FSIQ and VIQ that are in two different columns. So I can express, you know, FSIQ minus VIQ across subjects, but I can't do a test of SFSIQ versus VIQ, right? So I'm going to have to message a bit the data, and the way I'm going to do this is I'm going to do a separate data frame that has one column that is IQ, and where I'm grabbing the FSIQ, and another column that I create that is type, and I call FSIQ. I do another one for PIQ, right? So I have two data frames, then I have two columns, one which is the IQ measure, and the other one which is a categorical column that's telling me the type of IQ measure, okay? And then I concatenate them here, right? And then I can look at it, and it's basically one long data frame that has two columns, one which is the IQ and the other one which is the type of IQ. And then when I have this, I can express this with the formula framework, okay? So how does IQ depend on the type of IQ? And now the context in which I apply this is the data long framework, okay? So I've done this operation where I'm taking two columns that are of the same nature, concatenating them in one column and adding a categorical variable. I find myself doing this quite often in my work. Basically switching from a paired statistic view to a non-paired statistic view, okay? And then if I do this, then I can, you know, print my summary, and I can look at the summary table here, and I can go back to what we did earlier with t-test independent, and I find that I'm finding the same thing, right? The t-value is the same, except I flipped the order, and the p-value is the same, okay? So basically what I'm showing you here is that in a framework of formulas, we can compare two populations exactly as we're comparing them with t-tests. And apart from the data messaging in the panda data frames, it's nicer. Now, what's really interesting is that we can start now adding different factors. So, if you want to go back to the picture of the regression, we can start, you know, fitting a z variable, which may be the weight as a function of age and height. Okay, so it becomes more interesting. So you can see this is a 3D fit. And one example of application is if we look at iris data set. So iris data set is measures of a petal and sepal width and length across different irises with different species. So one question we can ask is that, so in general, you know, bigger flowers tend to be bigger. So if I have a bigger petal width, chances are I'm going to have a bigger petal length. But if I take this effect into account, is there also an effect of the species of the iris? Okay? That's the kind of questions I might be interested in asking. And we can do this using the formulas. So I can read the use pandas to read the CSV file. And basically the CSV file, I haven't shown it here, but it has different columns, sepal width, name of the iris, and then petal width, things like this. So then I can ask, how does the sepal width depend on the name of the iris, which is a categorical variable, and the petal length, which is a continuous variable? And a stat model is going to build a model to fit this, including the fact that name is a categorical variable and this is a continuous variable. And I fit this, and it tells me all this. And at the end of the day, I get that I have an intercept, which I'm probably not interested in. I have the fact that I have three different species of iris, virginica, versicolor, and I forgot the last one, which is hidden in the intercept. And I have sepal length. And so for each one of these, I can look at the p-value. So basically, is there an effect of petal length on sepal width? P-value says yes. Right? It's tiny. Is there an effect of the fact that the iris is virginica? Yes. Yes and yes. Okay? So the nice thing about this formula framework is it allows you to formulate a model that links the data and the statistical testing in the same model. Okay? This is, if you were to write this manually, this is a bit tricky because you need to keep track of the different variances that are explained by the different data to be able to feed this in a t-test. So just basically don't do this at home. And so by writing this, we get the different effects estimated together, right? And then finally, one thing that we can do, I'm going to skip this. You can go back to this. This is very important for, if you're doing psychology, this is very important. But I mean, basically what we can do, no, I'm not going to skip it, but basically what we can do is that we can now do a post hoc test and say, okay, if I care only about the difference between this guy and this guy, I can write what I call a contrast, which is basically doing arithmetic on these. And so the arithmetic I'm going to say is I'm going to drop intercept, I'm going to drop this guy, I'm going to take this guy minus this guy, okay? So the contrast vector is, I'm dropping the first one, I'm taking the second one, I'm removing the third one, dropping the last one, okay? And then I get another statistic, which is an F statistic, and it has a p-value, and so is the difference between those two guys significant? No, because p-value is above 0.05, okay? Another 10 minutes, so I'm going to skip this exercise. So, I mean, just to summarize here, what's important is we've done much more than testing if there's a difference between versicolor and virginica. We've tested if there's a difference between versicolor and virginica, removing the effects of petal length, okay? That's very important. Because if you're going to model real-world use cases, you're going to have, you know, is there a link between wage and experience removing the effect of a number of years of education? Yes or no? That's the kind of questions you're always going to be interested in asking. Speaking of which, let me switch to a slightly more rich data set and maybe more interesting. And introduce in the last 10 minutes Seaborn, which is a library for basically doing statistical visualization on panda data frames. So we can get this data from the web that is basically giving wage as a function of many other personal information, such as education, whether the person was living in the South or not, gender, experience, whether the person is in a union or not. So we can just load it, and it's loaded in the examples, and then look at it. And now we can do a scatter matrix using seaborn. So seaborn calls them pair plots. And we can look at wage, age, and education. And one thing we can easily add is to run a linear regression on each of these dependencies. All right? So if you want to see the code that generates this, just click on the figure, and it'll get you to the code that generates this. So this is a scatter matrix. By now you know them, and it's giving us the trends, okay? So basically, what you can see from here, let's just look at the upper part. So wage as a function of age and education. So experience, basically, at work and education. So what is more important? To spend time, you know, studying, or to spend time as an experience in your work, based on this? Studying, right? The slope tends to be bigger if you have longer education, okay? Then one thing we can really easily do with seaborn is to add a categorical variable as a hue. So basically now we're splitting the data and we're displaying males and females. We're displaying scatter plots for males and females and fits for males and females, okay? So, blue is one and one is female, so blue is female, and zero, green is male, okay? So, can we say things like, maybe, so, zero, green, male, maybe when males get older, their wage increases more than females, yes or no? This is a visualization. This is not statistical testing. It's really important to do it because we're going to see things like outlier points that might drive our regression, but we're going to want to build statistical testing on this, right? So we're going to do it using formulas. And for this, so we're basically looking at this. Actually, sorry, we're looking at something different here. We're looking at the fact that education seems to be less important for females than males for wage, okay? So we want to do a formula for this, okay? So I'm gonna pretend I can write it. So it's gonna be OLS, and then I'm gonna look at wage as a function of gender and education. Is this gonna do it? If I'm asking the question, it's probably that it doesn't work. But why? I know you're all tired. There's another 7 minutes till we end.
This will force both genders to have the same slope with education.
Excellent. That's exactly it. Here, we're just modeling a difference in intercept, but not a difference in slope, okay? And that is not our hypothesis. Our hypothesis is not that there is, for the same level of education, a difference in wage, but our hypothesis is that education matters less for females than males, okay? So for this, we're going to need to do what's known as an interaction. And the way it's written is a multiplication, right? So we're writing this as education, gender, and the interaction between education and gender, right? It's the kind of stuff that in statistics, there's the term interaction, and if you know it, you know how to find this. But if you don't know the term, then it's hard to find. So once we've done this, it's the same old story. OLS, we give it a formula. The formula captures our model, which is that which depends on education, gender, and the interaction between education and gender. We give it the data, we fit it, we look at the summary. The summary is telling us that many things, what we're interested in is in the interaction between education and gender, we're looking at things like the t-value or the p-value, and we can see that in our data, this is just slightly not significant, right? Because the p-value is 0.056, right? So we cannot claim based on this data that there is an interaction between education and gender. So what we're going to do is maybe just go back to the field, acquire more data, and hopefully it's going to come out. Okay? One last thing. I'm gonna run this to be able to show you. So I'm going to, where am I? I'm just going to switch to the example directory, and I'm going to run this example. So it's the wage education gender. So you can have it by clicking on the figure, as usual. Okay? And so what we've just done here, we've plotted an OLS, an ordinary least square, and we've looked at okay, so that's what we have, and we've looked at the results. Now, if we look at this figure. And there's something I don't like in this data at all as a statistician. I hate those data points because they're outlying, because they're driving my distribution. And basically, all the standard models in statistics have the assumption that things are Gaussian distributed. This is not Gaussian distributed. This is sticking out. So one thing I might want to do is to no longer use an ordinary least square to model this, okay? Right? So, I mean, you think of it as I take this guy and I push it this way with only one guy. I'm going to skew quite a lot. The green curve. That's very dangerous because, you know, one person is not telling you much, okay? So for this, I need what's known as robust statistics. Statistics that are robust to noise in, well, basically they're robust to violation of the distributions. And I can do this in, oops, what did I do? I can do this in, stat models by basically no longer using an ordinary least square, which is based on the assumption of Gaussian noise, but say to use a robust linear model, RLM. Okay? So now I'm using a robust linear model, just changed one tiny thing, and now I can look at, Okay, now I can look at the results. And they're still not significant, I believe. Typically, when you use robust statistics, significance goes down, not up, okay? Now, I've slightly lied to you because the model that we're using here is a Huber regression. It's very hard to give p-values for robust statistics, something very hard. And the model that we're using here is robust to outliers in the y direction, not the x direction. So it's related to your question. There are other models that do this, but then the p-values are going to be very hard to derive. And it's you're getting into statistics land, like where you have to know what you're doing. But I just wanted to show you that you can change the type of model that you're fitting, and that it basically is changing the assumptions on the distribution of your errors. And that may be important. Though most often you'll just use a linear, least square model. Okie dokie. Take home messages. I think I've drilled through the idea of hypothesis testing and significance, which is basically the basis of inferential statistics. It's very important. You cannot claim something just because you've observed the difference. You need to compare this difference with a measure of noise and the distribution of noise. Formulas. I chose to focus this tutorial on formulas because I found in my own work that they're incredibly powerful, that they allow me to formulate most of my hypotheses in very simple ways, and I tend not to get things wrong. There's much more than what I've shown. You can express functions. Suppose you want to do nonlinear fit. Well, you can always add a square variable, a cubic variable. Now, if you're getting into really nonlinear fits that are much more complex than a polynomial, you might not be able to do it with formulas, but then you're getting into things that are much harder to do in statistics. And either you know what you're doing, or you shouldn't be doing this. We were discussing this with Federico, who had to run away. But basically, if you're doing like complex nonlinear models, and you don't know what you're doing in statistics, you probably shouldn't be doing it, period. I want to stress that visualizing data and simple model fit matters a lot. You can only do this with simple models. Like if we're looking at a high number of variables that interact, it won't work. And finally, the idea of conditioning, which is to say, I'm going to look at the dependency between, say, age, so between wage and gender, taking into account experience, conditioning on experience, removing the effect of experience. That's extremely important. There's so much bullshit said in, say, the general news about, oh, this thing is linked to this thing, because there is an intermediate cause, okay? An intermediate effect that you should condition upon. And that's one reason why I really like the formula framework, is it makes it really easy for you to condition on different sources of variation, right? And this is, if you want to do statistics, I think this is extremely important. The way you ask the question, therefore the conditioning, the confounding variables that you add will completely imply the result that you get. Okay? And there's the famous quote, statistics, there are three kinds of lies: lies, damn lies, and statistics. Thank you.